One, I created a core team. We all thought the same. And these are the people who have stayed with me for many years, and they are great entrepreneurs by themselves. And second, we ensured we taught them down the line how they are going to do the business. We have created entrepreneurs at all levels. Like all my front end, we have an entrepreneur. There's a manager. He owns that point of sale. He's on variables. So that drives. And that drive, guys, is huge. You need to see it to believe it. I recommend everybody, right? If that model can be brought in, building an entrepreneur at the front end, he hires, he fires, you give him an SOP, he adjusts to the SOP, you make him dream the same way you dream, and the magic is there.
Brilliant. I think that's something which is worth looking at, because you know what he's done, I think, in his business, from the little conversation I had earlier with him, was that each of these 377 points of sale actually is run by an individual, and that individual has a ownership stake in the business. So he might not actually invest in the stock, but he's certainly got an investment in the sale. And in that process, I think, you know, making sure that that one individual is responsible for the hiring and the performance management of the other people who work along with him at that point of sale, and creating that incentive to grow and incentive to earn is, I think, one of the credos of your success. Rafiq, on the other hand, you've got a business which is in Chennai, and your business is something which started, 106 years back?
Yes.
And you're the fifth generation in that business. Or sixth?
Fifth generation
in that business. And you know, sometimes what does happen is, and I've seen this in several family businesses, everybody's very happy living off whatever the ancestors built. So they say, my father used to do this business, I will continue doing the same business. And the son says, my father used to run this business, I will continue running the same business. Growth and learning is normally incremental. But in your case, you've actually taken the call saying, this is what I inherited and this is what I'll grow it to. So obviously, four generations before you didn't want to do that. But in your stage, or rather, three generations before you didn't want to do that. But in your case, you decided to do that. So what made you want to diversify?
The need for growth.
Maybe it might help if you were to just explain the history of your business.
We have about 15 points of sales. Four of them are franchised, like Raymond's and Roy Phillips, and the rest are our own creations, including two supermarkets called Neil Reed's. So they're different businesses, and we're trying them all out with the help of my son, who's graduated and back in the United States. And he wants to grow the retail, and we're looking to see where there is a meet, and then we thrust in that particular format. And my job presently is to ensure that the 200 people that work for us, I connect with them on a daily or every other day basis, talk to them, touch them, feed them, just speak with them and keep them going, because I can see there's money available, there's material available, there is everything available, but manpower is the most important. So my job is just me to connect with them, speak with them, smile with them, eyeball them. 6,000 rupees girl doesn't speak a word of her own language. I speak with her, I bring the best out, and I make her smile, and I make her wish me every other day. I keep this going, and the next other thing I do is housekeeping. Just make sure that the bathrooms are clean, the car parks cleared off any other things that shouldn't be there. And, keep in touch with my son. Don't get too actively involved, you know, because both the son and daughter are very actively involved. And I encourage them. We've driven some philosophy, some fairness in the business, and to be fair to customers, to respond immediately. And everybody on the floor is given, first thing is please the customer. And by and large, we've seen that it's helped us in grow the business. Phenomenally well, except this last year retail has been kind of slow, but the supermarket business is booming, and I'm getting very interested in food business. And I'm happy to see that in this world there are a lot of people discussing food and possibilities of growing the food business.
Great. I think food and apparel anyway are the two largest contributors to the overall retail pie. So to that extent you're in the same right spaces. Sunil started a business which is largely what he calls his nuts and spices, private label products which he sells, and under the categories of nuts and spices. First generation, started this from scratch, has built an enviable network, 28 stores, 23 stores in Chennai and Coimbatore. And I think now I'm sure you've got aspirations to go beyond the Tamil Nadu especially, and getting into other cities and other states too. So what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, definitely. See, once our fundamentals and foundation is strong,
ICAs to at least seal the place where we are strong here. So in fact, when we started this business, I used to think that maximum we can open is about 5 stores because it's a high-end store. It's a premium gourmet kind of retail outlet. So we thought it was the 5 stores can only be taken here in Chennai. But then after 22, now we are considering having at least 10 more stores in Chennai. So when I have a scope as it is in Chennai and around Tamil Nadu, then why at all scale up and go other places where still we are not there. So in fact, we are just focusing on to the local market first, and then we definitely have a great plans to go entire nation, in fact of all the major cities. But
to start with, we have a plans to go for Hyderabad first, then Pune, and then probably going to Bangalore.
So when you want to look at expansion,
yeah,
and scaling up,
yeah,
two immediate requirements come to mind.
Correct.
One of them is finance,
yeah,
and the other is in terms of people.
Correct.
So what are your thoughts about how would you actually make sure that you skill yourself better and you capitalize yourself better?
I say finance is not at all an issue. In fact, today we are a zero debt company. So as far as financing is concerned, it's not at all a problem. Today opening about 5 to 10 stores per year is we can manage ourselves today. So we don't have to go for the outside funding at all. Yeah, manpower is a big challenge because we don't believe in hiring people at the top level and then do the business, because we believe in taking people from the lower level, elevate them in 3 to 5 years time to the manager level. There we see more loyalty towards the organization, and that is how we have grown. In fact, the last 15 years we have grown that way. From 57 lakhs to 65 crores is a journey now we have grown. So fantastic.
Great. And I think essentially the point that Sunil's making is that there is a diametrically opposite view between corporates and family-owned businesses in terms of actually building skills and capabilities. Normally what you see in corporates is that when they want to start a business, they always start with people at the top. Correct. And then they are the ones who are responsible for hiring people below.
Yeah.
And I think when families look at scaling up in terms of people capability, they look at people at the entry level and see how they can groom them in order to be able to take up more, higher responsibilities. And essentially, I think that philosophy also ends up, building greater commitment, greater alignment. Correct. With your team, such, yeah, that even if a large corporate retailer were to come and, meet up one of your store heads or your region heads and says, why don't you join me? He'll say, I've got greater commitment to Mr. Saklecha rather, yeah, than I will have commitment to XYZ.
I have a guy who has started at about 3,500 rupees and today is about withdrawing about 45,000 rupees. So I think in 10 years time or 12 years time, if he grows like this, I think the loyalty is much higher.
True, very true. We've got two textile experts, Mr. Maheshwari from Texpert, and we have Bala who's also got a chain of apparel stores under the name of Wenfield. Largely focusing on the apparel space. And this is a space which in India is, a lot of the large brands typically tend to cross about 1,000 odd crores, and then you consider yourself to be a large brand. But the market is so large that what we have seen is that there is the presence of so many small local brands which know how to understand the local tastes which are there specifically to a state, and then are very nimble and fast in terms of responding to market requirements and ensure that their models, that their entire business model has got a very high sell-through and very little which is left over for what we might define as the end-of-season sales. And I think both of these gentlemen here are people who've actually built their business largely on this basis. So would you like to share something about why, first of all, did you all get into the apparel space? And secondly, what is the courage that you had to be able to build brands in that space?
You see, Texpert India started by two entrepreneurs before 11 years. They were in the international marketing business. They worked with the large corporate houses of India. So they started their own business. And initially, they started with the indenting business of the fiber and yarn. After 3 years, they thought that we should create our own brand. They started two brands. Solmio is a corporate wear, and Fitz is a active wear and leisure wear. So initially, we started with the Spencer with few stores. Now at present we are having about 166 stores across India. We are present in 19 states and 77 cities. We are working with all large format stores like Reliance, Bharti, Walmart, Aditya Birla, Jubilant, Brand Factory, Spencer's, with everybody. Almost all the stores we are present with them. This company has three type of business. One is the international marketing services. Another is lifestyle products, apparels, and third is the e-com, online business. We have a strength of 360 persons right now. We have four overseas offices. Total in India, we have about five offices. Total turnover last year was about 150 crore. This year, we are going to cross 250 crores. And this company is started by the entrepreneurs. And it's a value of the company that they provide each entrepreneur. He can join, he can perform, work like an ownership business, and he is responsible for that particular area. So this is the values and guidelines of the company. Considering this, everybody is joining this company. Like I have worked 21 years before in the textile business with the composite mills. Then 15 years in export. I joined this company before 7 years.
So one of the points I wanted to understand is that, you know, it's sometimes so easy to be a contract manufacturer, putting somebody else's label on the shirt that you manufacture and supplying it to them, in which case you don't have to worry. It's a lot more difficult actually putting your own label on that same shirt.
Yeah.
And then going to the marketplace and trying to sell it first to the retailers and then later on getting it, them to be sold also to consumers. So there are, you know, it's a very different mindset.
Correct.
Between being, you know, comfortable with an assured business versus taking the risks of putting your own label on something.
Yeah.
So why did you take that risk to put your own label? Because that places you clearly in terms of competition with a different category of people as opposed to this.
We accept this as a challenge, and we have some professional styles. We are having good designers from NEFT, so we prepare all the range before one season. We present it to our team, we present it to our front-end team, area sales managers, and then we decide and we make the range our own, and then we present to the channel partners. And our experience is that everybody is accepting that. And even in some stores, when we withdraw, because of many reasons, store manager people are coming and they are asking, where is the Fitz brand? Why the merchandise is not available over here? So this itself, and our orientation is that we want to provide the customer a right product, value for money, with the quality, which other brands can offer it two or three times of the price.
Bala, what about you?
In our case, we were pushed to start a brand. We had a 220 square feet showroom in Chennai 18 years back, and a couple of brands at that point of time refused to supply to us. So once that happened, we decided, okay, let's start a brand, and that's how the entire journey started, from a 220 square feet showroom.
So this sounds like Mr. Kishore Biyani's famous story about why he started a brand, because Nagesh refused to retail him in Shoppers Stop.
Okay, this is like, I'm talking about my founder. He's Jagdish Sada. And the storeroom is Impressions, where lots of celebrities used to purchase from there. And we were actually trying to take the inputs from people like Rafiq sir, where we used to visit stores like them, who are like third generation, fourth generation, see what's happening there, and then try to imbibe those things here. So the journey started with that, and we were supplying predominantly to multi-brand outlets only. And only the last 5 years since that we moved into the EBO space. And all of this were existing multi-brand outlets who were selling our brand. They started taking a larger space in their own cities or smaller towns, and they created 1,000 square feet showrooms for us. And that's what, it was not even us, it was they who started this culture, which pushed us to look at this as an opportunity. And today we are on a 28 stores we have opened on a franchisee model. We are present in a couple of multi-brand outlets, around 400 in the country. And it's been a very, very, very encouraging journey for us. this particular.
Rachit, you've got experience across the US as well as Asia, and you've seen entrepreneurs firsthand in these kinds of markets. Are there things that you're hearing here today which are different from what you hear in, let's say, other markets in Asia? Say, for example, if you went to Indonesia and you actually met an entrepreneur and you had a frank conversation with them, would you hear the same stories? Are there different ways of doing this? Something that we might be able to learn, something that we might be able to export?
I think having worked in retail practically across most of the large retailers, and you know, we know that of the top 25 richest people in the world, 9 of them are retailers.